Yesterday, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame put a rock and roll landmark plaque at Cosimo Matassa's J&M Studios on North Rampart. That's the birth of rock and roll right there, and we really felt honored to be able to even give it a shot to make that happen. So thanks to everybody, to Ira, and so many folks here, to Heather West, to really pulling that together so well. The other thing I want to mention, that and the landmark plaque is part of that, is in the Rock Hall's American Music Master Series this November. We do this every year. It's our signature educational event. We are honoring Antoine Fats Domino and Dave Bartholomew as American Music Masters. We are really honored and privileged to be able to tell their story. Mr. Bartholomew will be joining us in Cleveland, as will John, as will Ira. And we're going to have a great week. You can find out about it on rockhall.com. But again, we're just really grateful to everybody here in New Orleans who's been so helpful. And it really is our honor to be able to tell that story, the story of Dave Bartholomew, the story of what happened at Cosimo Matassa's studio. It really is terrific. So I will hand things now over to Dr. Ike, I think, and we'll get rolling.
You know, it's great. It's really nice when you sit in the room and, you know, we've got Dave here, but it's also nice that you have Jerry Hall, Jim Russell, and, of course, Cosmo in the same room so they can all say, yes, we were there or we were around that stuff. All right. All the way on my left is distinguished writer who did a lot of the early research on New Orleans rhythm and blues, Mr. John Broven. Thank you. And the man who sits next to me needs really no introduction. His name is on countless songwriting credits on many of my favorite records. You can actually probably say that between 1949 to 1960, this man was probably responsible for about 80 to 85% of all the recordings made in New Orleans. He was an executive that was able to sign whoever he wanted, which was very rare for back then. He was allowed to pick the music, pick his own musicians, and he assembled the legendary Cosimo Matassa Studio Band. He's a songwriter supreme, you know, not only with the Fats Domino material, but Smiley Lewis, the Spiders, and countless others. His production skills are unparalleled, and as a trumpet player, they didn't call him old leather lungs for nothing. This is Mr. Dave Bartholomew. Great.
Oh, all right. Thank you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
So what we're going to do with the format is we're going to kind of play snippets of some of Dave's signature songs and kind of ask him the story behind it. And I think we really need to start with ground zero in terms of rock and roll. I think it probably is the very first rock and roll record. I'm not the expert, but I think that definitely there was something definitely new and driving and going on here that Dave was responsible for in heavy beat. So we're going to hear a little bit about about this song first to put Dave and Fats on the map, The Fat Man.
At this time, ladies and gentlemen. That was the first record that Fats Domino made in Cosimo Matassa's studio.
Dave, can you tell us about that session, how that came about?
That was the first record that Antoine and I made in Mr. Cosmo's studio. First, I'd like to say this, ladies and gents. Wouldn't be for Mr. Cosimo Matassa, I wouldn't be sitting here today. He made it possible that we could could get in the studio and say as long as we wanted. He would never get tired. And well, I'm glad he didn't, because we didn't have any money. He was always there for us, not only me. The late Lee Allen, Herbert Hardesty, not late. Fats Domino, not late, and so many others. And the great Earl Palmer, one of the greatest drummers in the world. We had everything going for us, ladies and gentlemen. When we heard Fats play the piano, nobody can beat him playing that type of music. He is the king. It has never really come out how great a piano player he is as a blues pianist, because everybody fell in with his voice and his 6/8, and that controlled the world. When we made the record, Mr. Cosmo Matanza said, "I think you got something." I didn't know what he was talking about. He said a million sellers, because we had only been making a little, few little records and giving them away, you know, that type of thing. This time we stuck it real great. And that was the beginning of Dave Bartholomew and the great Antoine Fats Domino.
Dave, when you first saw Fats, did you think that he was going to be an international star that he became?
I'll put it this way. Playing that type of piano, I put Fats Domino with anybody in the world. That man can play some blues. Just all you got to do is just start him. It's hell to get him on the bandstand. Once you get him on the bandstand, you can't get him off. And also, ladies and gents, when he started singing, where did he get that voice from? Everybody want to know what's going with Fats. That was authentic. It had a little bit of Creole in it, a little French. And when he said something, he meant it. Like, "I love you." Like, I first met John Broven in Germany. Next time I seen him was, he telling me to live it over here in the United States.
England, Dave, England.
Yeah, yeah, London, but yes. I saw you in England, but the last time I saw you, I pulled off in the bus and you was in the driveway. And that's what, next time I see you, and now you tell me you're living in the United States. So I want to tell you that I didn't know you was a stranger in our town. Thank you so much for that, ladies and gents. Getting back to Fats, authentic, everything he's saying, and say it comes from the heart. And when he played the piano, better know that the 6/8, nobody can, they tried it, but nobody can beat him doing it. Now, if you want to really play the blues, he's putting them like in a bribe pack. He's going to upset you. So we had 19 million sellers in a row. That's what Lucha told me. That was the honor of Imperial Record Company at 6425 Hollywood Boulevard. I commuted, like I would say, from 25, 30 years. At that time, let me make you laugh. I brought the records out there, and he said, "Well, you got to come out and master the records." Sure enough, went and mastered records. The next session I had was I'm walking. He said, "Dave, you got to come out here. But what you got to do, you got to get on the plane." He said, "Because the last time you come to a meeting, the train was 3 hours late. I mean, 3 days late, and you got to get here." I was afraid to fly. You see, that's the only way we're going to have you out here. And the rest is history, ladies and gents. We just went on. And Lucy, we had 19 million sellers in a row.
Dave, you mentioned I'm walking. We're transcending the time scale a little bit. But let's hear an excerpt of one of Fats' greatest records.
Actually, John, how about one other thing? Dave, how did you come up with the idea for such a heavy backbeat on the Fat Man that made the record different from most of the other rhythm blues records back then?
Well, the late Earl Palmer was a great drummer as well as a dancer, and quite natural. He made things that he could dance to because he was a professional dancer, at least. He knew what was going on in everybody's step, and that made it perfect so people could dance to him. The great Earl Palmer with his different beats, an educated beat that would fit any tune that we wanted to do with.
Yeah.
So let's hear I'm Walking.
Well, I'm walking.
Palmer.
Well, okay, now you're asking me what I'm walking. Bum tip, bum tink, bum, ba-dum, jump, bum tink, bum. He took it off the street and brought it inside. That's what I was trying to tell you, that the great Earl Palmer, the average band that is actually playing on the streets, bum tink, bum tink, bum tink, ba-dum, jump, bum tink, bum tink, bum. Earl Palmer was a dancer and a hell of a drummer. And quite natural, he mastered that. That's how we got the beat on I'm Walking and all the other tunes that we were instrumental in doing. Also, Josephine. I'm getting relayed a question over here. That's what I'm talking about. That's late. I'm sorry, that's Herbert Hardison. Our great saxophonist, Mr. Herbert Hardison. That was cut in Philadelphia. At that time, we were playing at the Showboat. And we would, one evening, we were just clowning around and singing and playing and having fun. I'll never forget, it was a Sunday evening. And we're just clowning everything. And all at once, we just saying, I'm walking. Somebody had something else. And that we had what is called at that time, one of the great guitarists of all time, a young man called Papoose. And he just fell in. And we just started from one thing, just jamming. That's the way I'm Walking was made. One of those times, just having a lot of good time. We didn't have the right words and all that. We just saw a clown, and that was all. There was a pep, place called Pep's right around the corner from the Showboat on Lombard and Broad. So you might say, well, how do you know about Lombard and Broad? Because the Showboat was there, and that was more or less like home to us. That was our home base in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. So that's the way I'm Walking, really born. And we actually finished it in Mr. Cosmo's studio. About a week or 2 weeks after that.
Dave, can you tell us how you met Lou Chubb, the record man of Imperial Records, and how he came to appoint you as the A&R man and branch manager for New Orleans?
Lou Chubb was my boss. Lou Chubb, at the time I met him, I was waiting for the Mr. Don Robey in Houston, Texas. Don Robey had all kind of great musicians, the great B.B. King and so many others at that time, a lot of blues kings that was there. Don Robey came to New Orleans, Louisiana to hear me and some other guys at the Dewdrop. But this Sunday when he came in, I was working at the Robin Hood. I was working Mr. Paul Gayton, also a great artist, great singer, great band, with the late
Annie Laurie.
Yeah. John, you know better than me. You want the mic? Well, Annie Laurie. So what actually happened, they said, I want to take off. Will you play in my place on Sundays? I said, well, okay. Well, I was doing a radio show every Sunday evening. I said, well, we just leave the studio, Mr. Cosmo Matassa. Would have us every Sunday doing things on WWOZ, I think, at that time. I might have the WWMRI, but they changed it at that time. Well, anyhow, make a long story short, so I was at the Robin Hood. Place packed and jam, I'm having fun. Here come this big man, look like he's 10 feet tall, all dressed up like a cowboy. He said, I like what you're doing. I said, thank you. And he said, I'd like to hear one of your songs, you know, Great Town. Fine. And he said, well, you played and you left a $100 bill. And I said, well, wait, how many times do you want me to play? One of those type of things. Sure enough, he's satisfied. And he said, I want you to come to my place in Houston, Texas. Sure enough, went to Houston, Texas, playing for Mr. Robey. And I went in there for 2 weeks, and I stayed there 6 months. And then, and in my, what I'm trying to say, in all the things that I was doing, just playing with him, an awful lot of people would come through and say, we like what you're doing, that's and so and so and so. But Lucha was sitting there, and I didn't know who he was. And he was making notes, like if I play it, I'm walking, or at that time, because I know I'm walking. But whatever, what I'm trying to say, whatever we were playing, he made notes of it. I had Great Town and things like that, and Stardust, all kind of tunes like that. So he said, well, I want you to play some of these things. So he sat on the side, and he said, I want you to play these tomorrow night. I'm coming in. So sure enough, I played some tunes for him. He said, I have a label at Hollywood, 6425 Hollywood Boulevard. I get it straight after a while. And he said, I want you to come up there and see what's happening. So Mr. Don Roper said, well, whatever he want, made him welcome and things like that. So what happened? I closed 6 months later because I was drawing an awful lot of people there. We went in for 2 weeks. We stayed there 6 months. The date was 1949. We brought in 1950. So sure enough, I started with Lou, and we never looked back. We had 19 million sellers in a row. Because during that time, that's how I found Fats Domino, Jewel King, 3x7, and so many other people at that time. Smiley Lewis, the great Smiley Lewis, was more or less, if I'm more than sure you down and remember, Smiley Lewis. Smiley Lewis was the guy that actually would start singing all the songs. And at that time, you had people in Nashville doing the cover. You know what I mean?
Dot Records, Pat Boone.
Ron, you know, Dot Records was covering everything that we were doing, and they were killing Smiley Lewis. What actually happened? So what we did at the time, we went on and made the records. And Smiley said, will somebody stop Dot Records from covering my records? Because at that time when he made that, I Hear You Knocking was covered. Blue Money, Fat made Blue Money on top of them, different things like that.
And one ain't night, that a shame?
Ain't that a shame? One night, and all that was done by Smiley Lewis. So anyhow, the main thing right now, the late Elvis Presley has a big, big record on. He got two or three of my tunes in his vocabulary that he was doing. So what actually happened one night? I happened to write one night, just to elaborate a little bit on what I did at that time, where I got the idea from. I had a big band at the time. We used to play for the Strikers Club in Mobile, Alabama. Very fine black club. And what actually happened, after that we were at a party at one of these iron houses that those people had at that time. And the young lady said, oh, I'm just having a beautiful time now. All these were actually people, you know, very, very, very instrumental, educated, what I'm trying to say, at this fine party. And this young lady got up, she said, I never had one night of sin. I said, what did you say? You never had what? She said, I never had one night of sin. I was saying, somebody give me a piece of pen, please. It really struck me. And I got home the next day, and man, I started writing on this thing. 2 weeks later, I recorded it. Lucy put it out.
Shall we play it, Dave? A little example of the record.
Please play it.
Yeah.
just that Smiley Lewis, the late Smiley Lewis.
Since we're on the topic of Smiley Lewis, Dave, why don't we talk about a song that's one of was probably Smiley's biggest hit that he once again got undercut by Dot Records.
I hear you knocking.
Yeah, can you tell us a little bit how that came about?
They killed Smiley on everything he did. Dot Records. I forget the guy's name that was in charge at that time, but he's just waiting for me to put something out, and he killed it with Smiley Lewis or whoever it was. But Smiley happened to be the man that they were actually picking on. I Hear You Knocking was another one. That went to Gail Storm. It goes on and on. They were just waiting for me to put something out. So I had to go along with it because I didn't know nothing else to do. And Lou wasn't doing a damn thing about it himself. Well, now that he's dead, I think talk about him too. If you know what I mean, dollars and cents. But what actually happened at that time, I didn't know. But Mr. Cosmo, Mr. Tass, I would go to him and say, Cos, they're killing us. He said, well, you know, it's just one of those type of things. Always had a nice word to say, well, Dave, that's and so, you know, that's the business. And we didn't know the business big time in New Orleans. I remember the young man who was just sitting here before I got up here, the promoter. He was talking about the Brooklyn Paramount, New York Paramount. They would be lined up 2 and 3 blocks waiting for Fats and I to come. And actually, what he said about the kids and things, the way they were carrying on, Alan Freed and so on, that was the truth. I lived that. I know what he was saying. I'm sitting in the back and said, every word he's saying. They end up putting us out of business. Man, we used to go there and we know we're going to make some money. Then all at once, they start fighting and things like that. And everything he said was true. And I really appreciate him saying it because that was bringing back memories. But that's where we got our start from.
So, Dave, should we hear a bit of I Hear You Knocking?
Please. Can I elaborate on that? Mr. Lollipop Jones and his wife was a comedian, and his wife, they had like a whole group of them at the time. So what happened at the Robin Hood, they were working there, and she would say, look, I'm sick and tired of you ripping and running all around and all those kind of stuff. I'm going to New York. Quite nice at that time. Everybody was going to New York. We all wanted to go to Harlem and be at the theaters and make an awful lot of money in New York. So she said, I'm leaving. I got a man that's going to take care of me and do all kind of things. I mean, brand new cars, a Cadillac. At that time, when you say Cadillac, everybody's eyes open up. Cadillac, yeah. So he started so smart. He said, well, what's going on, you know? And in the meantime, I'm sitting there and any kind of thing I can hear is a little different. I'm going to go ahead and jot it down. And the next day, I wake on it. So what actually happened, she went to New York. Poor Lollipop was crying. This on the stage. After he elaborated a little bit, he said, she's knocking at the door. Who's that? This is me, baby. I'm sorry. I'm back from New York. But I didn't mean no harm. You see, I mean some harm. Keep on knocking, but you can't come in. I hear you knocking, but you can't. So that's the way that was born. I hear you knocking, but you can't come in.
Dave, let's hear another of your great records with Fats. And I must admit, it is one of my personal favorites, Blue Monday.
Well, that comes from Smiley Lewis, too. That just goes to show you what I'm saying. The late Smiley Lewis, he would start and it would kill him dead. The poor man died of a broken heart. And he was broke in his pocketbook too. And everybody else was making big names and all that kind of stuff. In the meantime, I'm sitting here and I didn't do too bad myself with it because I was a writer. But we didn't have to publish and own it. Lou Chud had the publishing. And here I stand, I would say 50 years later, elaborating on those type of things, but the man died with a broken heart. But some of those things actually happened in the industry, and I don't think it actually happens right now. I have my young sons with me, ladies and gents. Round it down, please. Well, at the present time, oh, a little down. Well, they have a studio that we are elaborating on. I intend to just let everybody know. Just watch out because we're going to come out there. They're going to come out there. They're going to kill you because they got a thing that born in the country by the railroad track so far back in the woods, you need a map to get back. But one of those things, that he's got thing going on right now. It's something I wrote a long time ago. I don't know if it has any value, but the way he did it, it's 19. 19 years ahead of time. He's way ahead. Ladies and gents, they got something going. Next thing.
Dave,
do you want to talk a little bit about the story behind Blue Monday, which many people consider to be your greatest creation?
Well, Blue Monday was a hell of a thing. You know what like actually happened? I was playing at a place where the late President Truman lives. My fixed Independence, Louisiana. I'm Independence, Missouri, right out of Kansas City. In fact, you must have heard the story before. We didn't get paid. Did you know that? Playing in Kansas City, actually, about 20 miles from President Truman's house. Always so happy and everything. And the late Earl Palmer, always after we get off at night, he gone hang out. I don't care how far it is downtown, he gone, you know. So what happened? I think the man gave me about $1,500 front money, which was a whole lot of, we gone to Kansas City. We passed President Truman House. I said, we don't have, not too far from President Truman House. He said, yeah, you fall 30 miles from me, 30 miles in the woods. I said, Independence, Missouri. I said, well, okay. What made it so nice, this man had his own kitchen, little nightclub and everything you could get your red beans and rice and whatever, and he had everything going for him, you know. Till that Saturday when we got started playing, I went to him, he was supposed to give me my check before we started playing. It's 8 o'clock that night. He said, oh, don't worry about it. At intermission, I'll have all your money for you. Man, don't laugh. He's smiling. Sure enough, intermission, I saw him going out the door. I said, well, he going to his house and get the money. He been gone for the last 20 years. You laugh right now, Lord, I'm with a broken heart. I said, oh, Jesus Christ, what is this? So sure enough, Earl said, well, look, you know, putting us going home now, he always has some ideas. We just play tomorrow, which happened to be the Sunday, and we'll take the dough, because on Monday, it's Blue Monday. I said, look, you got it wrong. Saturday is the people, that's the day to hang out and have fun, not Monday. He said, here in Kansas City, it's Monday. I said, well we ain't got nothing to lose. Gas at that time was $12 a gallon, so we said, well, we'll take a chance. Sure enough, man, Sunday we made a little money. Oh, we was rich. I could give my wife the $5. Everybody had a little $5 going back. Plus, don't forget the sardines and crackers that we had, too. Sardines and crackers and things like that. Vienna sausage. We built them up, you know. Don't worry about nothing. We're at home. Well, sure enough, we had a good time. Monday evening, I said, let's go. The club's open. Man, boy, they was having fun on a Monday. I said, what is this? I ain't never seen nothing like this in my life. Not Saturday, Monday. The Blue Monday in Kansas City, that's how that was born. Another man did it by the name of Mr. Smiley Lewis, and he got covered on that. Everything Post Smiley did, John, you know, he was always covered. It was just one of them kind of things.
Ladies and gentlemen, I think we have to remind ourselves that that every record that we've played so far has been a Dave Bartholomew production. I think if any of us had recorded just one of those records, we could go to heaven very happy. Dave has just hit after hit, wonderful record.
The same day he cut The Fat Man to put on the map, he also had another million seller by Jewel King, 3 times 7 is 21, which tends to get lost in the you know, people forget about that one, and that was a huge hit. Can you talk a little bit about that, Dave?
Yeah, my son works and live in Tampa, Florida. And one day about 5 years ago, I heard somebody, we were working at a school that night for a prom or something in Tampa. I don't remember, must have been it's longer than that. I hear somebody, hey, you Dave Bartholomew. I say, I don't know nobody here in Tampa before my son Ron went there. It was Jewel King. She said, I quit playing music because I got no money. I don't have to do nothing but stay home and teach. I don't have to go on the road no more. Well, thank you for 3 times 7. That was Jewel King. And at this time, Lady and Jesse want to play 3 times 7. Jewel King, 5 minutes.
Talk a little bit about, ask Dave, that after that and The Fat Man both became hits, they organized a tour with Dave's band to go on the road with Half Fats Domino and Jewel King to go on the road, but Jewel never quite made the tour. Can you talk about that, Dave?
You know something, Ira, Dr. Ira, you know what you're doing? Make me talk about hard times. Well, right. What happened? You all said to go on tour. You know, you got Fats and you got Jewel, 2 million of them. But I can't tell them what to do. I wrote the songs and everything. I mean, they arranged it and all that kind of stuff. To get them to go together, that's hell. Oh, man. Fellas, ladies, you want to cry, bring your crying handkerchief with you. The booking agent comes to town and sign it up. I'm telling all them, yeah, we got 3 months on the road. We're going to get rich. Jewel's husband says she can't go. Now, he done put all this advertisement out all over the United States. What is this? So Fats say he can't make it. Jewel ain't going. So I'm set then. So they cancel it. The only thing I'm trying to say is this. You can sit in the studio and do what you want, and Mr. Matanson can tell you that. But once you get out there, you come in and, hello, how you doing? You know, as soon as they make a hit, well, right there. You know what I mean? Sophisticated. And I got to put it with that shit, you know. Saying that, but most people say that money don't change people. That's a damn lie. It's a damn lie. But I tell you this, ladies and gents, I'm very satisfied with what I've been doing. And I'm not rich by a long shot. I was too honest. A lot of people still with me, like my good friend Herbert Hardesty, my musicians that are still around. I've lost most of them in the band that were actually with us on all those hits. Ernest McLean is still working at Disney World. Mr. Billy Diamond, who traveled with us, he's still in Los Angeles. But what I'm trying to say at this time, I don't know what else we have to say or to do, but I want everybody to know that without this man sitting over here, and I mentioned it today, tomorrow, and days to come, that the only way I really made it was with Mr. Matassi at my side. I was always. I mean it, Carl. Stopped me from crying a lot of days. And I tell you one thing about what's going on right now. I just want everybody to be happy. Not only in my family, we had a hell of a thing going here, distraction with the storm and stuff like that. But I think we all got our hearts in the right place right now. With a little luck, I think we'll make it. God bless all of us. I thank you. Yeah.